Hello and welcome to Your Library at Home. My name is Em Mirisch and I'm part of the Library's public programming team. And I'd like to begin this evening by acknowledging that we meet on country. I live and work on Gadigal land, and I'd like to take this opportunity to thank my elders past, present and emerging. I also extend that respect to any Aboriginal people that may be joining us this evening. Welcome to our latest in our series of author talks. This evening, we're joined by Katerina Bryant, who'll be in conversation with Michaela Kowalski. Katerina has just released a fascinating new book called Hysteria, currently available to buy online from the State Library Bookshop. I'll see you all again at the end of tonight, but I just, first of all, it's my pleasure to introduce our interviewer, Michaela. Michaela is an interviewer who has worked for ABC, Radio National, local radio. Excitingly, she has recently in June, curated ABC's first ever online festival, Writers Festival, the big weekend of books. Recently, she's also interviewed Margaret Atwood, Tim Flannery, and also Trent Dalton. But tonight, she is, of course, in conversation with Katerina Bryant. So, Michaela, over to you.
Thank you very much, Emily. It's an absolute pleasure to be here this evening. I wanted to start by just telling you quickly how tonight will run. Katerina and I will speak for about 45 minutes, and then we'll leave a good 15 minutes at the end for your questions. When you're ready to ask them, or if you think of them as we're going through tonight's conversation, please feel free to pop them in the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. And also, if you run into any tech issues at all, you can pop those questions in the chat box. And we do have members of the State Library of New South Wales who are online tonight, and they can help you with any problems. Before we begin, I wanted to give you both Katerina's bio in a moment, but also a sense of this profound and quietly powerful book. The book is part memoir, part analysis of the endemic sexism and narrowness of the medical profession. But it's also something where Katerina writes about her own experience of mental health, how her own experience of mental health changed and evolved. And in the book, she also beautifully considers why she writes about it and why writers write. Hysteria is a beautifully nuanced look at what illness is and means, the full complexity of the brain and the mind. But it's also one of the most beautiful considerations of what selfhood means, especially when illness shakes the foundation of who we think we are. Katerina Bryant, I want to tell you about before we get going, is a writer whose work has appeared in Griffith Review, Kill Your Darlings, Island Magazine, Voice Works, and many among others. She's also been listed for the 2019 Lifted Brow and RMIT Nonfiction Lab Prize for Experimental Writing. She's currently a PhD candidate in creative writing at Flinders University, and she lives in Adelaide. And Hysteria, a memoir of illness, strength, and women's stories throughout history, is her first book. Now, there are a lot of strands from my introduction that we're going to pick up in tonight's conversation. And I wanted to start by asking Katerina if she could talk to us about the symptoms that she started to experience when she first started to experience these changes in her mental health, in her mental state. But I think the best way for her to do that perhaps is to give us a reading. But I firstly want to welcome Katerina and say hello and welcome to your first
event. Thank you so much, Michaela and Emily too. I'd love to do a reading. Before I do, I would like to say that I live, work and study on Kaurna land, and I would like to pay my respects to elders past and present.
Thank you.
Get right into it. So I'll be reading right from the get-go on the first page. As I wheel the trolley into the supermarket, my partner Matthew, already ahead of me, picking out plums. My head begins to rush. I feel light, as if my bones have been taken out of me, and I float along, buoyant. I'm only flesh and blood. Matthew comes back, placing the crinkled bag in the trolley. You all right? I hadn't realized, but since of the rush of air filling my mind, I haven't moved. I'm standing still, frozen, a meter or so from the entrance. The trolley is empty, bar the plums. I don't answer him. I'm caught where I'm standing. A stream of air pushes through my head. I haven't moved. K, Katie, a name only Matthew and my parents call me. I barely register his lips moving. I move my eyes away from the silver lines of the trolley and up to him. It's hot today and the warm weather has made his hair curl up into its natural rings. I can see the thickness of his brows behind his glasses. I mumble and try my best to nod. It comes out slow and measured, as if I'm trying to hold a conversation while reading. Matthew takes the trolley from my hands and pushes forward to scoop up mushrooms. I follow him with slow, short footsteps. My movements are a fraction of the speed of those around me. I'm immune to the urgency of Sunday late afternoon shopping. Matthew places the mushrooms in the trolley and I can just smell their earthy scent. I look at their duotones, brown and white. They are small curls stacked up in a tray. They remind me of snails, and somewhere inside me I hear snails in the supermarket and the hint of a laugh. I follow Matthew, pinching the cotton of his t-shirt like a toddler would, moving towards the aisles. We walk past the fish, open-mouthed and eyes gaping, and I feel curious alarm. Did they always look like this? I look at the women and men behind the counter. They wear rubber aprons with brown leather straps. One is talking to a middle-aged customer with thick, red-rimmed glasses. The seafood line trickles out into our path and I struggle to move my body past the knot of people. I grip Matthew more tightly. He leads me away, pulling me into the safety of the aisles. I stand by the trolley as he runs up and down, filling it with our staples. Tofu and pasta, canned tomatoes and cheap soy milk. I can feel his annoyance. I've left this all to him. I will myself to move, walking down the aisle and loosely pulling the trolley beside me. I make it to the cracker section. What do we need again? My eyes cannot gloss over the brands as they usually do. They fixate on colourful packets and thick text. It's beautiful, the bright mix of cardboard reminds me of driving up to Lobethal to see the Christmas lights for the AYA. The cardboard shimmers under the gleam of fluorescent lights. When we reach the checkout, I start to become myself again. As I come to, I can hear the music, Christmas carols playing in heavy loops. I ask Matthew, have they always been playing? He looks at me, confounded. He continues stacking the conveyor belt. I pay and carry out 3 of the 5 bags back to the car, an act of penance. When we settle into the warmth of the car, I begin to speak. Short, choppy sentences come out. I'm sorry. I don't know what happened. It was too much. My spindly hands grip my knees. Matthew reaches out to them. I notice the line of hair on his forearm creeping up to his hands. It's okay, he says. Let's go home. This is just the beginning. I think this is what it's like to go mad.
Thank you, Katerina. And congratulations. Thank you.
Ah, thank you.
There's in the book, you do trace quite early on that in this moment in which we kind of meet you and your world is changing. And in a moment, I'm going to talk to you about the journey, and it is a journey you went through in terms of trying to diagnose and get advice and get clarity about what it was you were experiencing and therefore what kind of treatment you would get. But this was not your first experience with your own mental health, was it?
No, I have experienced anxiety and depression and OCD throughout my lifetime, but this felt distinctly different. I think it moved into the realm of mental illness that we don't talk about. So if people move into experiences that resemble psychotic episodes, for example, we don't have that sense of understanding as a society that we have worked towards with illnesses like anxiety and depression. So I really felt like a fish out of water because these experiences were so unlike anything I had heard about or experienced myself before.
And you write about that in the book, that a lot of the professionals you come into contact with also don't know what to tell you. You know, one woman comfortingly says to you, well, you're not psychotic. And you're like, well, that's a start. But, you know, there's all these different things that you start trying to carve away from. Is it the brain? Is it the mind? Could it be epilepsy? Could it be something else? But I wanted to ask you, because you write a lot in very creative and different ways about illness, about the idea of illness. And I wondered, how did you think about illness before you started to experience what became these sort of chronic seizures of yours?
I think before this experience, I think I felt a way that many of us felt perhaps before COVID, was that I felt an inherent trust in my own body and its ability to perform. And by perform, I mean to get me to the shops so I can buy groceries for the week. And I took that perhaps for granted as a given. I did not understand how illness could affect an ongoing existence, and also how illness is something that we will all experience, and our bodies change, and nothing in our experience of the world and then thus our selfhood is fixed.
Mm-hmm. There's a later on in the book, there's this idea of, you know, of illness as growth, you know, that what's the possibility that illness is actually a kind of a transformative thing that happens. But before that, your book really focuses this idea that socially held ideas of illness are all about it being abnormal. They're all about it being, they're being bad. In your book, you write, sickness is a problem to be solved. It's the sixth lack of control that creates fear. And I wondered if you could talk a bit about that, because from the research you did and from your own experience, illness seems to be a very big part of a lot of people's lives, and yet we have this construction of it as very abnormal.
I think people who live with chronic illness or people with disability often conceptualize and build their lives in adaptive ways, which, being one of those people, I think is quite, it's necessary, but it's also brilliant because it often allows us to focus on what is important. When you have, as they say, so many spoons in the day, you have to figure out what you will use those spoons on. And I think the idea of limitation, as people outside of that experience may view it, the idea of constructing a life that may not consist of a 9-to-5 job is quite foreign, and it moves away from concepts of what a good life is. So I think it's easier to dismiss the individuals challenging that life view than to really look inwards and think about how one structures a life.
And you quote some very, very beautiful and very pertinent research. And you know, there was a line from a psychiatrist that was an interview in the New Yorker in 2018, where he says what you just reflected, that we haven't really done our due diligence when it comes to certain kinds of mental illness that we don't understand, and we still try and put the same construction on top of them. I wondered if you could talk as well about some of the language that we use around illness. You talk in the book about, you know, illness being, the idea of illness being a battle, you know, something we have to fight. But after a period of time, you said you started to feel like, if I have to fight illness, then it's like fighting myself. How did you make peace with that, or make sense of that for yourself as you were going through it?
I think the tools we're given when it comes to an experience of illness is narrative based. So we are told that illness is a narrative arc that we will come out of on the other side as different and well again, whatever well may mean. And this idea does not reflect the reality of most people's experience. But I found myself really confused, because that was the narrative I'd been taught. I'd been reading and learning that you fight your way through something, but an illness can be part of yourself, and accepting certain constraints does not mean giving up. It means adapting. And I think we stick within this idea of adapting means failure. But for me, adapting is growth, and it paves the way for happiness.
There's a lovely way in the book that you sort of, it's almost like the holding of hands between being a writer and experiencing your mental illness or your mental changes. And you write about how in writers' groups, you know, people say, you're supposed to say, I'm not my writing. My writing is not me. It's something that I do, but it's not of me. And then you also talk about that in relation to mental health or mental illness, that when or sickness, for example, that when people are diagnosed, say, with cancer, they say, I have cancer. They don't say, I am cancer. But when it comes to mental health, if someone is bipolar, they say, I am bipolar. How did you make sense of that for yourself in terms of, as you talk about being a writer and also having your mental illness kind of evolve and progress in a way? Was it useful to try and imagine it as something separate from yourself, or was that something you had to bring into who you are?
I think if you imagine, for me at least, if I imagined it as separate from myself, then it kind of falls in that narrative idea of something you must fight. Whereas when it's a part of your existence and perhaps a part of your identity, but not your entire identity, it's easier to accept and adapt. So I think it's the real kind of tension between understanding it as a part of yourself, but not as an all-consuming part of yourself. And I think the push to move away from having illness as a key part of your identity is in itself ableism. It constructs illness and disability as something that should not be talked about and worn proudly, when I don't think that's the case. I think people talking about their illness and or disability shows a lot of strength, and there's so much to be gleaned from those conversations, and we should be having them.
And I think your book makes it very clear that I hadn't read about what you'd experienced before. I hadn't come across it at all, and I do quite a lot of reading. So it's that moment where you start to think about all the stories that haven't been told. It's something that actually comes up a lot in your book. The chapters are named for different women, and I wondered if you could tell us about who they are, because you sort of give voice to them, and they're people who suffered from mental illness in the past, but who were voiceless, weren't they?
Well, I don't like to say that I give voice to them or they were voiceless, because part of what means a lot to me as somebody who researched them was they had so much strength and integrity in their own circumstances that I feel like a very small piece of that puzzle.
I think to clarify, what I meant was that they reading about them was an example of where we read about them through the eyes of the people who treated them. We didn't often, except for Edith, the first person who I'd love to tell you about, we didn't get to hear what their experience was like of being institutionalized, or their experience was like of having a mental illness, or their experience was like of being on show in the moments that they were. That's what I meant. But tell us about them, because they are Edith, Mary, and freakishly another Katerina, but not you.
Yeah.
You at another time. Tell us about those three women. Why did you want to give chapters that in effect to them? Why did they become pillars in the book?
I think pillars is such a beautiful way to phrase it, actually. I felt more that I wanted to share that these people had given meaning to my own experience. So viewing who they were and understanding them connected with certain aspects of my own experience of seeking medical help and going through all those hoops. So like you said, out of the four women, only one, Edith, was able to speak really for herself. She was a psychoanalyst. And a big pleasure for me as a part of the book was finding at the Library of Congress via email some of her poetry and being able to include a poem that had been unpublished until now in my book. And that felt as though it was in service of her and a small way to perhaps repay her memory for the meaning she imbued my life with.
The story of Mary Glover, who's in the middle section of the book, is a young woman whose experiences maybe weren't entirely dissimilar to the ones you experienced in terms of some of the symptoms of having a kind of a seizure and then feeling frozen, of being frozen, of not being able to move parts of her body. And in the time in which she was written about, it was considered that she'd had a spell put on her by a witch. She'd been, you know, sort of somehow enchanted in a terrible way. What did reading the history of someone like Mary Glover show you about the way the medical profession viewed her kind of mental illness, but also viewed women in that context?
It was interesting because Mary kind of encapsulated the split in history between witchcraft and the medical profession. So in the court case for the accused witch, the doctor who had seen Mary advocated for the witch, I'll call her, why not, to say, no, this is not a spell, this is an illness. And I think it's really interesting that she embodies all of that, but at the same time, she's very young and we have records of her words as transcribed by the priest during her exorcism. And seeing the way she blames herself for her own experience of illness and how she wishes to be free of it was uncanny to me, because it reflected a lot of my own thoughts about myself and also a lot of ways I've heard other women speak about their experience of illness, particularly mental illness. So to see those things verbalized, you know, hundreds of years before my own life was just made me think about how longstanding these ideas about women and punishment and illness kind of are wrapped up in.
The story of Katerina, who's the third young woman we meet, she's 18 and she was a patient of Freud's. She met him, you know, high on the hills when he was sort of having a bit of a holiday, and she told him about her own story. It was another example of the way sometimes it seems like patients or people who are experiencing symptoms try and fit themselves into or are fitted into a paradigm that already exists. What are the dangers of that? Did you experience any of that yourself? What did Katerina's story say to you about that weird kind of complicity almost between practitioner and patient?
Yeah, Katerina was interesting because Freud used her case he wrote her case in a specific way to show that because of her youth, her, you know, innocence, as he wrote it, although I do not agree with his interpretation of her, that she was a much more compliant patient. And so that is why she gets a resolution and she is well. And it's being compared to his other city patients, women who did not receive the same kind of freedom that Katerina was granted from Freud because they were not compliant and did not go along with what he was saying. And I've definitely felt that within the kind of charge of a relationship of being in a doctor's room, talking with them about your experience and knowing, having to judge when to push back and when to let certain things slide. I was saying to you earlier when we were chatting about the many instances where certain psychiatrists had said to me, oh, you're not like this patient, and told me quite intimate details about a patient that, with a sense of wanting to reveal and be complicit, that made me, of course, incredibly uncomfortable, because it felt, as soon as I walked out of the door, who are they saying that
about you?
About me, yeah. So there's a very weird, charged relationship that I think is reflected in Freud and Katerina's relationship and still in contemporary times.
I wanted to ask you specifically, when you wrote about the seizures that you were having, the first, when you started Googling, like people do when something strange is happening to their mind or their body, you kept finding this thing called depersonalization, which I had not heard of, and I'm maybe guessing that you hadn't heard of either. Mm. But I wondered if you could talk a little bit about that, because it was, I think it was back in the 1950s, in the DSM, in the Diagnostic Statistical Manual, it was actually listed kind of under the heading of hysteria, wasn't it? But what did depersonalization, what did it mean on paper, and how did you experience it? What was it like as a experience for you?
Well, depersonalization is a specific experience under the kind of umbrella of dissociation. And what I was surprised to learn is how common it is. I think most of us will experience it at least once in our lifetime. The most common experience is in a car accident, that sense of being outside of yourself or above yourself, or feeling like an alien, or you're in a movie, a kind of unreal quality to your sense of self. And then in relation to that, derealization is the same idea, but in terms of recognizing objects. But what was really interesting to me is how common and everyday this is. People can experience this regularly, as I do. And talking to friends made me realize this is something we don't talk about, but is a part of the experience for so many people. And as you said before, it makes you think about, what else aren't we talking about? Whose else's stories aren't we hearing?
There's a description of it in the book. Someone writes, it's terrifying to think that we're all vulnerable to a lapse in selfhood. One of the most extraordinary things I think about this book is the way that you consider and start to untangle what the self means, what it meant to you, but also what it means, how we've described it over hundreds of years in psychiatric ways, the distinction between the mind and the brain, that and also the mind and body kind of dualism as well. But I wondered if you could talk to us a bit about the way that starting to have these mental illness changes, this experience of seizures that you had, changed the way you think of yourself, and also changed the way you think about reality.
I suppose, funnily enough, the answer for both of those questions is that it made me realize nothing is fixed. Everything morphs and changes over time, and that is not a bad thing. That's just what it is. To really consider concepts of self when you feel not like yourself, and when the objects around you that you see every day are, for me, a part of my derealization was not recognizing trees, which was very disconcerting, and realizing how grounding these little daily things are. But at the same time, once they are gone, while they are disconcerting, you are still you, and you still have that sense of strength and your own relationships to kind of hold on to, which I did. But not only relationships in terms of my family and friends, but relationships with women throughout history. I began to see myself not as entirely an individual, but connected to a series of women who have had a lot of strength and resilience and agitated for change and treatment. And that made me feel as though I was not alone, and that I was fixed, even though things had an unreal quality.
Who were some of those women who agitated for change?
Well, one of Freud's patients, or actually his mentee's patient, Bertha Pappenheim, she was known as Anna O. And her psychiatrist at one point said that he, in his notes, that he wished she would die because he thought it would put her out of her suffering. But she went on and she lived, and she created a feminist Jewish movement and uplifted women around her. So just these small kind of agitations, and in her case, a big agitation, but I'm sure every interaction she had with her psychiatrist, she was pushing against those ideas about who is strong and who should be listened to and what wellness and illness means. So there's so much I see in history that has been written and recorded that I feel a part of, but then also there's so much I can imagine, which is not usually how we think of history. But there's so many interactions I can see which would have had required so much strength, and that has really uplifted me too.
I think we are going through a moment, definitely, in, it's been happening in academia, I know, for many decades, but it's filtering now both into fiction and nonfiction, of writing people in who've been left out, of writing people in from the margins, and of helping to give a more full picture of the experiences of people who are either considered not important or whose records weren't kept in the same way. So I think works like yours are part of that as well, which is really wonderful. I want to stay with something before I ask you about writing and about memoir, but you write as well really powerfully. As you said, that you describe it to your father during one of your seizures, that you can't recognize a tree, you don't know your own street. But you also talk interestingly about objects. You talk about the way that objects lose their reality and their meaning. But I wondered if you could talk a bit about, what did you come to understand then in writing the book about the importance objects hold in kind of making up our identity?
That's really interesting. I love objects as the kind of duality for me is in, we hold on to things because they give us comfort, but when we cannot recognize them, we experience discomfort. So they're very layered. And for me too, writing this book is now an object. So I've created an object out of an experience, and I'm able to hold that experience literally, and what that means, I'm still thinking through. I still have my brain scans from this time. So 3 years later, I hold onto these objects that don't necessarily give me joy, but ground me in the sense of building up a part of who I am and being part of my own history.
There's a lot in the book as well. You talk about that you sort of start writing more than you speak, as in these periods where you haven't, your seizures are changing, and they go from being kind of quite acute to being, as you say, like a kind of a crumbling reality. You know, they stretch out into, they break up over everything, but you stay indoors more. You realize at one point you haven't left the house for 7 days, but you also say, I think more than I speak, and that you speak less, and you do your thinking through writing. And I thought you're kind of a wonderful person to ask about this. I wondered did you find that thinking more than you speak altered how you think or what you think? That you were expressing it through, when you did express it, you were expressing it through writing, not through speaking?
I think it didn't necessarily change how I thought, but it changed how I communicated. So as I was writing this book, I was handing chapters to my partner and my mum, who are always my first readers. But then we didn't know this was a book. This was just what I was needing to do to think through this process. So instead of verbalizing, I was able to write, think, write, and then share. So they knew what I was feeling internally. So I think it just speaks to the layers of communication and how it doesn't have to be an in-person conversation to be meaningful, which I suppose we're all learning now.
Yes, very much so. But so you play around with that idea, you know, it's not, your book isn't writing as healing. You didn't, you know, it doesn't sound to me like you set out to write a book to heal yourself, but writing is not a failed cure though, is it? Like, what have you found? What have you found, as you say, now that you've got an object now, you've got this actual thing, but it also is a, you know, it sounds like in the process, you even talk about it in writing the book, as the book goes on, that the form of the book starts to shape your own experience of your illness. How do you think about that process of writing the book now and what it's sort of given back to you?
It's strange because flipping through the book now, I can stumble upon memories that I've since forgotten. And so...
Is that weird? Does that feel weird?
It is weird, especially when I think about the idea that if I were to meet somebody or a friend had just read it, they perhaps would know that time in my life better than I do. So that's something to think about, I suppose. But it's talking about it through writing. My experience through writing the book was not, you know, as you said, it was not therapy. It was not therapeutic. It was, I suppose, a thought experiment more than anything else. But then I had to go back because you don't write a book in one, you know, pass. And what became really interesting to me was as I was editing it and then also proofreading it. So I'd have to read, you know, some sections are traumatic for me. And then to have to read that four times to make sure each word is right is, I wonder what that does to somebody in a sense of recording how we think and who we are and then what we focus on. Because while I may have forgotten things that are in the book, I wonder how much I remember outside of what's recorded in the book too. Mm.
I often think that's why we tell things to people, whether it's especially friends. They as you said before, they remind you of things that you've said or done. And you think, did I say that? Did I do that? There's something powerful about it. It's almost like other people as receptacles of our own memories and they can kind of shine them back.
Mm. Yeah, everybody, I suppose, they say your friends are a mirror.
Mm. Very much so. It seems a good moment to ask about memoir because, as we've said, this book is it's a combination of a lot of different kinds of writing. It's research you did. It's the way that you were reading to sort of make sense of what was happening to you. As you say, it's a thought experiment, but it's also a memoir in a lot of ways. Mm-hmm. And I wondered, you know, what appeals to you about memoir as a form of writing?
I think memoir is compelling for me. I started out writing fiction many years ago and I couldn't make myself write. It was slow and painful, but with memoir, it's something I needed to do to think through my life, which I think is thinking through how you're structuring your life and building something and your daily habits. I think that's the difference between surviving and living. So memoir allows me to live in a really complete way, I think.
Mm. Were there other memoirs that you've read that you loved the structure of or you loved the shape of that you were thinking about when you decided that this your writing would become this book?
Yes and no. The book is perhaps a cousin of Siri Husfitt's The Shaking Woman. And it's really funny. I was reading that book very early on as I was undergoing diagnosis. So that definitely influenced me, but also books like Fiona Wright's whole body of work, means a lot to me. I loved Elin Sachs's memoir, The Center Cannot Hold, about her experience of schizophrenia. So I think books about women's experience of their body just always really grip me. But then also I love, it's very left field, but comedy that speaks to women's experience of mental illness. So folks like Maria Bamford and Aparna Nanchala bring a lot of light while thinking through what it means to be embodied as well.
Mm. You write very beautifully about your family and your partner in the book and the power of their support. And you also, you say things like, a partnership like this is a privilege and I've grown into a more complete kind of love. And they're very beautiful lines about experiencing that kind of unity and communing when a lot of other things in your life were changing or fracturing. And I wondered if you could talk a bit about that experience of being able to, as you say, your sense of reality, you realized it wasn't fixed. Your sense of self, you realized was not fixed, but yet you were still, you were able to continue to build and cultivate these very powerful relationships with the people closest to you. Do you think that was in part because the relationships were so strong beforehand, or is it about people? I suppose I'm wondering, is it about people having empathy, giving you space, not judging? What constitutes that kind of support?
I think a key part of it is communication, and writing for me allowed me to communicate in certain ways. Having existing relationships where you've got a strong pattern of communication, but also my family has experienced a lot of loss. So we're quite unfortunately practiced at rallying around people in illness and in times of need, which I suppose, thinking about it, all families are, right? So
not all families have processed it, and not all families have kind of not integrated it, but are able to know that it's there and build on it, so that it's like a shared experience as opposed to an experience that sends people hurtling off into their own grief.
Yeah, it is very much a shared experience. And I think that adds layers of complexity to me writing a book about it, and to those family members reading certain parts of the book. My partner proofed the book as well, as another pair of eyes. But it's my choice to write my experience and to then publish it. And he never chose to reread those sections, but he did. So there's so many layers of complexity when writing about things like this. But also, he did say to me recently, he reread it and he thanked me for writing the book. He said it allowed him to understand parts of himself better, and that was a very, I suppose, meaningful, almost closing of that chapter for me.
Mm, to use a good metaphor. I think one of the things that stayed with me very much, I'm going to go to questions from our audience in a moment. So if you have some questions, feel free to keep popping them into the Q&A box. I can see there are some there already. I think what stayed with me in the book was your very, very powerful but very gentle consideration, as we've talked about the complexity of who we are and what makes us who we are and who we become and who we keep on becoming. Mm-hmm. And I wondered, it's a hard question to ask, but how do you feel right now? You know, the book's out in the world. You're where you are. You've gone through all the different, you've met lots of different medical professionals along the way, some great, some less great. You've
been mostly less great.
Maybe mostly less great. We were kind and we spared many of them tonight, but you've had all kinds of words thrown at you, you've had all kinds of diagnoses thrown at you. But I wondered if you could talk about how you feel right now about who you are becoming, you know, with the chronic seizures and all that that entails as a big part of your lived experience.
I think for me, I feel now that because the book itself is an object, that a part of that narrative is to hand the book over to readers And so it's no longer about me. It's about what that experience becomes to other people, which is really just a clever way of me avoiding that question, I think. Yeah.
It was a clever way of avoiding it, but that's okay. This is now to avoid it. We might come back to it. I want to go to some of the wonderful questions from our audience. Someone's written, were there any other cases that didn't make it into the book that struck you in your research?
So there are so many cases of women and so many in the Blanche chapter. She was in the hysteria wing under Jean Charcot at the Salpieri Hospital, and so many women and men were there, and their experiences still kind of live on. There is an archive in that hospital. So I found myself latching onto these specific stories because I saw myself in them, but there are so many stories that kind of have touched my thinking and my life, but they almost feel like a background rather than a specific instance. I think in a way these women and myself are, while individuals, are really pillars, I suppose, of an experience, and we are not ourselves in a certain way. We are that experience.
That someone else, Laura, has written, can you describe your experiences with the medical system and how you think that was shaped by the fact that you're a woman?
That's a wonderful question, or I suppose a tragic question. I think to be a woman, and also to be, if you are gender diverse or non-binary, is to be treated with suspicion by the medical profession, even if the people you are speaking with are themselves women. There is a kind of patriarchal structure imbued in the medical healthcare system, and that cannot be escaped. So there are certain ways in which we present ourselves that I found for me that meant I was able to be listened to better. So wearing makeup meant I was respected more in an appointment than if I was not. And I suppose if you were chronically ill and you're going to so many appointments, you can really test out the waters. But it's a really painful system to go through. And I think we often are told as Australians that we have an impressive public healthcare system, but I do not think we do, especially in how it treats people experiencing severe mental illness, and within that, women and people of colour, and especially First Nations people.
Someone else has written, Katerina, what are your thoughts on our current changes in social connections and the impact that has on our mental health? Would lockdown increase symptoms of depersonalisation?
That's a really interesting idea. I think for me and my own experience, I have found being inside and being more alone has meant that there are less triggers for me. So conversely, I'm experiencing less symptoms than perhaps I ever have before. That is not to say that is the case for everyone, because I'm sure it is not. But I think the problem now is that because perhaps more people than ever would be experiencing dissociation or as a stress reaction to lockdown, that it is more difficult to find help and to access that.
Someone else has written, it's a broader question, was there a particular moment or incident that motivated you to write the book, to bring all these things together and imagine that you would actually put it together as a book and release that out into the world?
So the story of Hysteria coming into being as an object is almost quite accidental. So I was writing as I was experiencing. I felt during this time I couldn't do very much because I was so unwell. I could only really work once a week to live. And then, you know, I had 6 days left to go to appointments and to fill up the day. So I felt like my identity was being tied to productivity. It has always been tied to productivity, which I now recognize as problematic and ableist. But I felt as if I was writing about it, I was able to hold on to a part of myself. And then a short essay I published from this book with me, Anjan, and then my wonderful publisher, New South, approached me. And when they did, I was like, a wonderful opportunity that I have not thought through at all. And I sent
Let's
off
take
a manuscript.
Up that one.
Yeah. And I was like, oh, they won't want this. And when they did, it was quite a surprise. So I never had the chance to think through what it meant writing this and then putting it out. It, you know, life got away from me there.
It's maybe a happy not yeah. accident, but a happy in the way that it evolved. Someone's actually, there's a question I was going to put to you as well. Someone said, can I ask about your PhD? Is it focusing on similar topics of women's experiences of mental health?
So it is focusing in a way on similar experiences of women whose stories in history have not been remembered, but it is the biography, it's a hybrid biography and memoir of the first woman clown in America.
Wow.
So mental illness doesn't play as much of a part in the next one and in my PhD.
Fantastic. Someone else has said, I find myself unable to concentrate enough to read on and off due to ASD. Is Hysteria going to be available in audiobook form? And also thank you for tonight.
Oh, thank you. I'm not sure. I would love that to be the case though. And I would really be passionate about it being audiobook for accessibility reasons as well.
Mm. I wanted to ask you before we go, we do have time for a few more questions. If other people want to ask any questions, they're welcome to. I wanted to ask you though, one thing I didn't get to ask you before, we were talking a lot about language and the language that we use. And I realized when we were talking about, you know, the difference between saying, I am cancer or I have cancer or I am bipolar or I have this disorder, as well, that there are words we use that we throw around in common usage, like mad or hysterical or idiot or crazy, those kinds of words. And I wondered, what do you think about the word mad now when you hear it, when you hear someone say she's crazy, or she's mad? But I also want to ask you about the word hysteria, because there was a point at which what you were experiencing fell under that broad classification.
So I think language, well, obviously I think language is powerful. I'm a writer, of course I would say that, but I think how we talk about illness is not particularly, as a whole, as a society, well developed or empathetic. We often say somebody suffers from something or is afflicted by, when
it's always negative.
It's always negative, and we're also always making a value judgment about somebody else's experience rather than taking their cues. I find it difficult to hear that kind of terminology when used to describe me. I much prefer, you know, experiences seizures or experiences mental illness. I also think we often conflate mental illness and mental health, which can be problematic, because I think it's often a way to shy away from mental illness itself, because they are not the same thing. And for example, funding for mental health is vastly different to funding for mental illness, and conflating them is not necessarily helpful. Mm. So language is very powerful, and I think especially so when, like me, you are really, you know, fascinated by history. And as a part of this book, I did, although it's not in the book, look at the legislation around mental illness and disability, and seeing some of those words used that we perhaps use without meaning to be offensive now because it's not within the same context, still kind of makes me feel tense, because we are all a part of that history. And at the same time, though, it's difficult to change patterns of language, and we can just try, and we can just listen to people and try and be empathetic as much as possible.
When you talk about that, the distinction between mental health and mental illness, and that often people use one interchangeably for the other as a way of shying away from things, you also write about the difference in the book between the mind and the brain.
Mm-hmm.
And you said that if there'd been something wrong with your brain, your treatment would have been cheaper.
Yes.
I was really struck by that as an analysis, and disheartened by that as well. Is that because there's so much about the mind that we still don't understand and can't measure?
Well, there's still so much about the brain we don't understand or measure too.
But I wonder, why is one treatment considered more expensive than the other?
I would just say stigma.
Right. It's as simple as that.
I think so. I think neurology, while obviously there are lots of things, a specialist is always, you know, expensive. But when I did, and I'm still on a wait list for neurologists, so it's not a great system either way. But I think so many people experience mental illness, and there is so little support for that. And so if a session with a psychiatrist is $400, which it often is, how is that going to be accessible for the majority of people? Isn't. And even with a mental health care plan and the subsidized psychology sessions of 10 a year, that subsidy does not cover the entirety of the session. There is still a profound gap.
Mm. Another question has come on just before we have to hand back to Emily, which is, you mentioned dabbling in fiction. Would you come back to writing fiction ever, or poetry?
I will never say never. In my current book I'm writing about the first woman clown, I am inching towards fiction slowly through biography, because there is so little left of her. There are parts I have to imagine. So I'm slowly inching towards fiction, but I'm not quite within it yet.
I like it. One of the attendees tonight said, thank you for your writings. Hopefully you'll empower more people to share and to be who they really are and to be authentic. And before I hand us back over to Emily to conclude tonight, I wanted to thank everyone tonight who was here and watching and with us. And also particularly to thank you, Katerina, for your beautiful book and for speaking about it with such openness tonight. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Thank you, Michaela.
Emily, back over to you.
Thank you. I totally agree, Michaela. Thank you for your talk tonight, Katerina. And I want you back at the library to hear about the clown. Thank you so much, Michaela and Katerina, for both of you in conversation this evening. And before we go, on Saturday, 12th of September, we're live streaming a conversation with Dara Gwimmin, Leanne Watson, Erin Wilkins and Jasmine Seymour. And they're talking to historian Grace Kaskins about the way we learn about the past and present, our histories, place, and how we discuss identity and culture. So you'll find all the information similar to how you found out about tonight on our library website. So please, if you could visit our What's On page and register in the same way, we'd really love to welcome you all back here tonight. And once again, Katerina and Michaela, I'm actually, believe it or not, speechless. That really was very moving. And thank you so much for your conversation. But Katerina, especially your sensitivity and bravery. It's really beautiful. Come back again on Saturday night, everyone. And thank you again for your library at home.